Okay, and we'll begin in just a few minutes. As folks settle into the virtual space. Janette, I love your background.
Thank you.
So excited to talk about some of those pictures today.
Right. A lot of history.
Yes. And is this actually your studio?
Yes, this is my studio, and I always have a lot of art on the wall, so which I change from time to time. But let's see, if I can move over here. See, there's a mashup right there behind me, Keith Haring. What else have we got? Boy George, Big Daddy Kane. There's a mod girl, and Run DMC right there.
That's amazing. So many artists who I love. I'm so thrilled that you could join us today and to talk about so many of these photographs and the people in them as well. So we'll go ahead and get started, but welcome everyone to this family program, Photographing City Life, a live session with photographer Janette Beckman offered by the Museum of the City of New York. I'm Joanna Steinberg, the curator of education programs, and this is the first of the MCNY Kids Create series that offers art making and live discussion with New York City artists. So this broadcast will be recorded today. In today's very special program, you'll meet famed photographer Janette Beckman, see her incredible photographs of New York City scenes and people, and be inspired to take your own photographs. Janette will walk us through the creative process and talk to us about how we can tell stories through the camera. And so Janette's career begins in Britain, photographing youth culture and punk musicians. And she moved to New York in 1983 to photograph the underground hip hop scene. Through her photographs, she captures the unique styles and personalities of so many hip hop legends before they were famous. And many of these photographs appeared on album covers and music magazines, and so many of them are memorable to us. She's photographed for fashion labels, has taken incredible images of street life in New York City. And today you will see all of these photographs, including her recent images of the demonstrations for Black Lives. And so we will be sharing this wonderful video in just a minute. That captures so much of her career, but I just want to add that she's shown her photographs worldwide, including the museum's 2015 Hip Hop Revolution exhibit. Her photographs are part of the collection of the Smithsonian National Museum of African American History and Culture, and are also in our very own collection at the Museum of the City of New York. So enjoy getting to know Janette through her works and through this exciting video that covers so much of her career.
They become iconic over time. You don't know that they're iconic when you do them. They're just striking. You know it's striking. Wow, that's dope.
And we were responsible for all of Def Jam's visual identity.
Well, the thing about Janette's photography to me that is so special is that she has this amazing technical ability, but there's just something about the way that she communicates a message with her camera focused on a subject that's really, really special.
No one can really take our pictures but Janette. You know, when we first met Janette, like, it was just so cool. She just came straight to Harlem. So that lady's like the only one who will ever let take pictures of us. Like, I mean, she kind of has like a hood pass, as we say.
And I'm like, my life is really crazy. From the streets to La Mode, that's really an incredible thing for me.
Thank you.
these images are captivating, but the person behind them is equally dynamic. It is my pleasure to introduce Janette Beckman. And Janette, would you like to say a few words to open up the session so that people know what to expect today?
I'm just honored to be a part of this and have my photos actually in the Museum of the City of New York collection. And I'm a huge fan of the museum. And you know, I've pretty much spent the last 40 years, that's 10 decades, photographing all sorts of people. People at the beginning of their career, like LL Cool J, who was maybe 16 or 17 when I photographed him for his first ever press picture. You know, and he later became the LL Cool J we know now. He's a famous actor, musician, and so much more. A lot of, you know, a lot of these folk that I photographed were at the start of this. Also photographing a lot of people on the street too, who were not musicians, just regular folk.
Well, I think it's such an amazing opportunity today to hear directly from the artist, to look closely at the images. So Janette, in this session, we'll be sharing some of the behind the scenes stories about the works that you're about to see. And then she'll be providing guidance for how we can take photographs of city life. And there are many ways you can participate today. We encourage you to participate through asking questions. If you go to the bottom of your bar where you see the button that says Q&A, you can click on that button, a box will pop up, and you can type in your question for Janette throughout the session. We will be holding up some of these questions throughout the program. And if you're joining us as we're live streaming on Facebook or YouTube, only participants who registered in advance who are participating on Zoom can participate in the Q&A, but we hope you enjoy watching through whatever format you're joining us today. And so Janette, we'll go ahead and get started, and I'll begin with some questions about when you first picked up the camera. How old were you? When did you begin to photograph seriously?
Well, I probably got my first camera when I was about 10 years old. And of course, back in those days, it was a film camera. You know, it was probably, you probably heard of this, like a box brownie or something. And I actually began to photograph my family, you know, take a picture of my little brother and, you know, the cat, whatever was going on in my life, which I'm going to be encouraging you guys to do later. And, you know, then I went to art school and I really love portraits. I grew up century. And it really gave me a view of what life was like back in the day. And I decided I wanted to do that. So I decided to pick up my camera and study photography at an art school. And that was it. And I think, would you like me to speak to the photo that's on the screen now?
Who are these individuals? And I know this was one of the early photographs that you took as you pursue photography seriously,
Yeah, this is actually a photograph I took. I was straight out of art school and I was teaching in a college, and the kids that I was teaching were basically, they were 16 and 17 years old. I was just a couple of years older than them and I was trying to teach them photography. And one day I went out into the schoolyard at lunchtime and there were these two guys standing outside in the schoolyard, just leaning against the wall there. And of course I had my camera and we were using this stuff we call film, which you guys are probably not familiar with, but we used to have to, it's film. This is what it was, not digital, this is what it was. But so I asked these guys if I could take their picture and they said yes. I took this picture. I maybe took 5 or 6 shots of them. And it turned out that we actually lived on the same block in London, in North London, and we became friends. These guys were identical twins, Chaka and Dubem, and they were actually, their mom was from Nigeria. And they used to do this amazing thing back in the day. They would hang out outside location, which was called Highbury Islington, with a boombox and just play music for the commuters. So every night, like from 5:30 to 7:30, you would see them outside there. They were playing music, they would dance a little bit and just make everybody happy. And this was not a paid gig. They were just doing it because they loved music. And maybe, I don't know, this photo ran in the first issue of a magazine called The Face, and it was a full page photo. And they became famous. And about 12 years later, there was an exhibition about, and as you can see, they're dressed very stylishly in a museum in London. And this photo was blown up 12 foot high, hanging in the entrance. And they were there and I was there. It was just a great moment.
I love picturing it at 12 feet high. It's such a striking image. And just to show other participants some of the other photographs in this phase of your career, Janette's capturing the mods, fashions and images of some of the neighborhoods where she photographed. And I know in 1983, you came to New York to photograph the underground hip hop scene. And I'm curious, you know, what drew you to hip hop at the time? What made you want to photograph artists and musicians?
Well, I'd already been photographing the London punk scene, as you mentioned, and I'd photographed all these famous bands from the Sex Pistols to Boy George. I'd done album covers for the Police when they were all just beginning, I have to say. The Police were a new punk band when I photographed them, and they became like a stadium band playing at Madison Square Garden. And then in 1982, I was working for a music paper, and the first ever hip hop tour to come to Europe came to London. And we didn't know what hip hop was. And they sent me down to take pictures. I went to the hotel where these guys were staying. It was more like a kind of sleazy Airbnb, actually. And I just started taking pictures of all these people. And this is a guy, Grand Mixer DST, and I was just completely, at the show later, I was completely blown away by the music, because not only was it music, it was art, it was dance, you know, there were break dancers, there were double Dutch girls, there were graffiti artists, Futura was there, Ramelzy was there, Fab Five Freddy was there rapping, Africa Bambaataa was spinning. And all these things were going on a stage at the same time. And we had never seen anything like this before. And I was so drawn to this. And a couple of months later, I was visiting a friend in New York, and all this whole hip hop scene was happening all around me. And I just moved here. I never went back.
Well, you took so many memorable images and, you know, so many groups and people we've come to love and know, specifically through some of these early photographs that you took of groups like Run DMC and Salt-N-Pepa. So I'm wondering if you could tell us some of the behind the scenes stories of these images in particular.
Sure. I mean, this is a picture I took in 1984 of Run DMC. And it was a time before cell phones, if you can imagine that, and before the computer even. So I got a telephone call on my landline from somebody in London saying, oh, we want you to go and photograph this group, Run DMC. And they gave me a phone number, and I called, turned out to be Jam Master Jay's mom's house. And, you know, she picked up the phone, she passed the phone over to Jay, and he was like, oh, sure, you know, meet me next week outside the train station. So I got on the train with my Hasselblad camera, my most precious possession, and, you know, got some film in the back of the camera, and I meet Jay, and we walk down the street, and he's just talking to me. And Queens, I had never been to that part of Queens before. It was a really nice neighborhood. Just walk down the street, and I see these guys just hanging out, playing music from their car. DMC and some of their friends in 1984. And they were not famous back then. This was just right before they were going to get really famous. And my way I photograph people, I don't really pose them because I like people to kind of assume a natural pose however they feel comfortable. So I was just like, okay, get a little bit closer together so I can get the picture. And I took this picture, and I think, honestly, it's maybe one of the most famous pictures I've ever taken and maybe one of my favorites. Not only because of what they're wearing, it is a moment in time. They're wearing the Adidas sneakers with no laces. They have gazelle glasses. They're wearing Kangol hats. It's definitely, it has a lot going on.
They definitely set the trend that so many of us remember. Not to mention Salt and Pepper, also trendsetters. And I'd love to hear kind of how this image came to be. What's the story behind this one?
Well, I actually had met Salt and Pepper before they even had a record out. And it was another thing where an English magazine had asked me to photograph these two girls, Salt and Pepper. And we had spent the day hanging out on the Lower East Side, you know, on Avenue C and D in New York City where I lived. And they were like, oh, we've got a record coming out. Would you be our photographer? I said, yes. We had a great time. And I did a lot of photo sessions for them. And this was maybe like the second or third photo session I did with them. And they arrived at my studio. It was for a record cover. And they just came in wearing these jackets and they looked amazing. And Netflix called, I think it's called The Remix by Lisa Cortez, which is tells you a lot about hip hop fashion. But these girls came with their gold chains, their hoop earrings, and they have these amazing jackets on, which were actually made by the one and only Dapper Dan, who basically clothed, you know, the best of hip hop. And, you know, we were just having fun posing, and we had a hair and makeup person at this point. You can see their hair and makeup is fabulous looking. And I don't know if you guys saw, I think a year or so ago, there was a Geico ad, you know, Geico insurance, and they're wearing the same jackets. Push it in the background, and they're pushing a lawnmower and pushing their button to go up in the elevator. It's so cool. And they look exactly the same. But, you know, we remained friends, and I did more album covers after this. But we always used to, we like to have fun. And as you can see, Spinderella is kind of goofing around. She's pretending to use their hats as turntables, which I think is really cool.
That's amazing. And, you know, I want to remind folks who are participating today, if you have questions for Janette, the way to do so is to click that button on the bottom of your screen that says Q&A, and you can type in your question right into the Q&A box. And we'll be reading some of those for Janette today to respond to. And, you know, I'm actually surprised to hear that so many of these images are not posed because they're so striking in terms of the gesture and how people are expressing themselves. And my favorite moment of the film that we just showed was when someone said that they would only let you photograph them. And so I'm wondering, you know, if you have advice for how to photograph people. It can be challenging for people to take portraits. And I'd love to know more about how you interact with your subjects and, you know, make people comfortable to create these wonderful portraits.
Well, that moment in the film where the guy says, we'll only let Janette photograph us, those guys are a dirt bike gang that live in Harlem. And I don't know if any of you guys live in Harlem who are watching, but you can see them, you know, roaring through Harlem. They're often doing wheelies. They're called the Go Hard Boys. And they were formed to keep kids off interest in biking rather than, you know, things that could get them into trouble. So I found out about them, and I met with the owner, with the CEO rather, who's called Shay. We had a meeting, and I showed him my hip hop pictures. And a lot, this speaks to a lot about trust of your subject. You need to talk to them, and you know, respect them. Like if you're going to take a portrait of somebody you don't know, a stranger, somehow or another, You know, it's a great thing to go up to somebody on the street and say, oh, I really like the hat you're wearing. You look incredible. Would you mind if I took a photograph of you? It's a question of, you know, you make a relationship with your subject. And that's how I personally have always done it. And I am not a really somebody that likes to pose my subjects. I like the subjects to be natural and feel comfortable when I'm taking their picture. So, you know, most important thing, especially if you're taking photographs outside or you're taking photographs in your house, you know, you don't want like a tree sticking out of someone's head because it just looks silly. So you can move them, and you want to make sure if you're using daylight that the subject has light on their face. So if, you know, you don't want the sun behind you because then it's going to be backlit and they're going to have shadows. And I've photographed a lot of people wearing baseball hats. So you could ask them to turn the hat around, or, you know, there are all sorts of things that you need to look at. But my thing is always to try and capture that moment and how that person is feeling at that particular moment. It's not about what I'm feeling. It's really about, you know, how they're feeling and the relationship that we develop in that quick minute.
And Janette, we're having some questions from the audience right now, but someone's asked what inspires you about someone's personality and how do you capture it? So how do you come to kind of recognize these things, especially as you're meeting people for the first time?
You know, I actually am very interested in all different sorts of people. I mean, it could be, you know, an older lady that I met on the street. It could be some kids, you know, playing basketball in the park. I am very interested in people. So that is very inspiring to me. I can walk out on the street, like when I'm sitting on the subway, even if they're covered in masks, you can still see what type of person they are. And I'm also looking at what they're wearing. You know, I'm like, oh wow, he's got some really old school sneakers on. You know, and I always want to take pictures on the subway. It's nicer to ask somebody rather, you know, to get their permission these days because people are a little wary. But, you know, you could, there's something, there's a feeling. And, you know, as I say, it's really about trying to build a relationship. I have a friend called Jamel Shabazz. He's a really famous photographer that I admire him. And he's an incredible photographer. And I was photographing people one day in the park in Brooklyn, and he would go up to people and go, hi, my name is Jamel Shabazz. I'd like to take a photograph of you. I see greatness in you. I mean, who could resist something like that? I thought that was an amazing thing. And everybody said yes. Mostly people, when you go up to them, if you're polite and nice, will let you take a photograph.
Mm-hmm. And, you know, for the young participants, definitely do this with an adult as you're photographing street scenes. But you might also want to start by doing portraits of people within your family who you know really well and feel comfortable with to really capture something unique and special about them. Another participant is asking, Janette, if you kind of fell into photographing musicians or if it's something you knew you wanted to do.
That's a really good question. What happened was, you know, when I came out of art school, punk was happening. And there were just, you know, kids with mohawks walking down my street. And I was really fascinated by that. And one day, and I took a lot of street portraits. And one day, I always loved music. Music has just been really important to me. I grew up listening to Motown, which was hugely popular in the UK when I was a kid. And, you know, I just always listened to music. And so I needed to earn a living. So one day I walked with my portfolio, which did not have any pictures of musicians, but I had a portfolio, and I walked into a music magazine. It was a weekly paper. And I was like, I just want to show my work to somebody. And I met this woman who's actually one of my best friends now, Vivian Goldman. She's a writer. And she opportunity to go and photograph Susie and the Banshees, which was a huge punk band. And I was like, okay. And then I went off and then I was like, oh my goodness, I have to figure out how to photograph a live band, which I'd never done before in a dark, you know, theater. Well, it was pretty amazing. I managed to figure it out. I went and took the photos and I came back with them. The next day I had a dark room. I would develop the film. I had a dark room. Came back with the prints the next day and she's like, these are great. And gave me another job the very next day. I got into photographing musicians. And, you know, I've always been, you know, music and fashion, to me, style, street style, all go hand in hand. And music has really been the rhythm of my life. I mean, and music is, especially now, you know, it's a means of protest. And, you know, you kind of think about musicians like Marvin Gaye and all of these people that I admire. And even punk was, you know, they were protesting about bad conditions in London. Thing, when you think about a song like The Message done by Grandmaster Flash, I mean, those lyrics just tell you exactly what it was like living in New York at that moment. You know, junkies in the alley with a baseball bat, that was what it was like where I was living down in what is now Tribeca. I think music is very important.
These next set of images are really interesting, but I'm wondering if you could talk to participants today about the recent collaboration you've had with visual artists and graffiti writers who have reinterpreted many of the images that we just looked at. So if you could describe to us what this concept of the mashup is and where the idea came from. It's so interesting.
The idea came from an artist called Say Adams, and you saw him in that video. Actually, he was the creative director at Def Jam and also an artist and a painter. Here he is. And one day we had been asked to do an exhibition by this woman, and I didn't know what we were going to do. And he walked in and said, I think what we should do is have my friends, graffiti artists, paint on your photos and reinterpret them. And I was like, why? Why would they want to do that? That's such a crazy idea. But lo and behold, you know, he reached out to, at that in the moment, 10 of his friends, and they all said they wanted to do it. So I had them look through my archive of photos, which they could see on the web, and choose a photo. Everybody had to choose a photo, and then I would make a portrait of them. This was the deal. And they would draw all over my photo. I gave them a print. In his studio in 1985, and it was for a story that ran in the Daily News magazine, and it was a cover story. And I had a really great day hanging out in Keith Haring's studio, and he gave me this huge, beautiful piece of like poster, which I still have on my wall. And Say was friends with him, so Say did his homage to Keith, which is a great mashup and a reinterpretation. And then we got 10 more artists. You want to go through a little bit?
Yeah.
There, so here's my portrait of Say. This is a reinterpretation of my lady, by Lady Pink, of my Queen Latifah photo. And Lady Pink is really, to me, the godmother of all female graffiti artists. She was the first. She was in the movie Wild Style, which was made by my friend Charlie Ahern. Shout out to Charlie. And she is an incredible artist. She's still making beautiful art today. And I love what she did to that photo, because that's even one of my favorite photos. But she's a very big fan of Queen Latifah. And she wanted to, as she put it, you know, reinterpret Latifah. And she said, she's my queen. And I just think it's really beautiful what she did. It's very powerful, and a lot of woman power in it. It's great.
Mm-hmm. And This was an artist who I'd learned about through you, Janette, but if you could tell us about Jules Muck and her reimagination of the LL Cool J picture.
Well, this is Jules, LL Cool J. I think that's why she did this interpretation. And as you can see, he looks a little sad. She put a teardrop. You know, this is actually, just to say, this is the first ever press picture taken of LL Cool J. And I took this picture in 1985. And he was just a kid. He walked into my studio with a big boombox on his shoulder, stepped onto my seamless, and he just, you know, made this gesture. And I took the picture, and that picture became his press picture. And in fact, you know, he used it not that long ago on a t-shirt. You know, we're friends. He's an incredible guy. But, you know, I love the fact that he looks sad, but he's got a heart on his chest. And there's Eeyore, I think it's Eeyore, sitting on the boombox, also looking sad. So I think it's a great interpretation. And Jules is an amazing person. She pretty much, if you follow her on Instagram, she does probably, here she is. She travels around the States with her dog. This is her dog, Dada. And she pretty much seems to paint a mural every day. And she'll just go somewhere, if there are any walls that want painting. And she'll go and paint a mural. This is one actually in Venice Beach where she lives. And I think it's beautiful. It's a great interpretation. And so you can see her clothes are all covered in paint. And I like this portrait because the dog is in it, of course. And, you know, her clothes are covered in paint. She looks like a wild artist, wild free child artist, which is what she is.
It's an incredible collection of images. And you said the mashup has become a book or a catalog?
Yes. Well, it's a book. Here it is. And this book came out at the end of 2018. And we had had a lot of exhibitions. The whole thing started when we had a little exhibition of the 10 original artists in my studio here. And it's not that big a studio. And I think, Joanna, you said you were here for that.
I was there. I had called you that day about another program and you invited me and I headed straight down. I didn't miss a beat.
It was so crazy because 400 people turned up to my studio. It was packed. It was a hot summer's day. We had beer for everybody. And, you know, it was a really beautiful evening. Everybody was talking about the art and getting along. But this book, the idea of the book, let me find a good one. Let's see. There's a lot in this book. So for instance, we started to travel the project, the 10 paintings around the country, in fact, around the world. Like I took them to Paris, they were in Geneva, they were in London, LA. And we had a little exhibition in Chelsea at the opening of this big, huge food market. And Zephyr, who is a very famous artist from the 80s, early 80s, here he is, Zephyr, happened to be walking by and he came to the show and he said, I want to do one. And he'd been in kind of retirement. So we were like, of course. And here is Zephyr's interpretation of my Run DMC picture, which I think is really fabulous. And, you know, part of this book is there would be a piece of his own work. And then this piece is from, let's see what year. Well, I don't know what year it is, but I think this is obviously an old piece. So every artist gets to show a piece of their own work along with a portrait. And this book is, it's got a lot of great art in it. You know, here's Queen Andrea. Let's see, we've got a lot of women artists in here too, which is rare. Here's a beautiful one of Chuck D done by Lee Canones, who's a really famous artist. And I was lucky enough to manage to get this picture of Lee when he had redone this mural in Coney Island. So, you know, it's a great project. And everybody gets to say when they started painting. So, you know, and why they chose the photo. If you like graffiti, I highly recommend this book. And honestly, you can get it on Amazon.
And definitely worth looking at. And Janette has encouraged anyone who wants to participate in this tradition of the mashup. You can look up her photographs on the museum's collection or on her website, which I'll show you at the end of the program. Print out a copy and, you know, add your own characters and tag and your own style to it. So it's so fun thinking about how to take images from the past and kind of reimagine them, reinterpret them now. I want to take a moment to, go ahead, Janette.
No, I was just going to say we've done workshops in LA and New York with the mashup where we've just given out prints and people have just drawn all over them and they've been hugely popular. It's really fun. Sorry.
And, you know, keep the questions coming. If you're tuning in now or came late, just know that if you click the bar in the bottom of your screen and hit the Q&A button, you can throw in your question to the group and we'll be holding up some of those questions for Janette. I'd love to take an opportunity to look at these street photographs that you took of New York. And the Museum of the City of New York has recently acquired many of these beautiful street scenes that Janette took throughout the 90s into the collection. And seeing them on Zoom, it's just a wonderful opportunity to look really closely at the images and to ask Janette anything about them and how she developed the work. And so I know some of the participants are sending in questions about your process and your approach, Janette, but if you have any advice for the young photographers who are joining us today about how to decide on the subject of their images, how do they take an image that really stands out? Any advice that you have about how to capture street scenes?
Well, all of these portraits were a part of a project that I was doing, and actually in some ways I'm still doing, where I would just go out with my camera and see somebody that looked interesting to me. I would just approach them and ask if I could take their picture. And this one in particular is this kid, Robin, who's selling newspapers on the street by Wall Street. And I don't know how old he was, but you know, he looks about 9 years old. He's definitely underage to be selling newspapers on the street, but it's definitely a captured moment where it, you know, it looks like it could have almost been taken in the 1940s or something. And you know, he's not even really looking at the camera. You can see he's like very relaxed. He's got his feet crossed. He's just leaning against the wall. And you know, that's always nice to give your subject something to do, like tell them to lean against the wall or hold a basketball or whatever makes them feel good. Could you just scroll back a little bit through?
Yeah.
And I can talk about maybe that. Yeah. This is a picture of three sailors that I took during Fleet Week when, you know, all these servicemen come through. And I wanted to sort of capture the idea that here they are in New York, and also the signage. It says, while naval ships are berthed, use blah, blah, the crosswalk. It just gives a kind of feeling that, you know, they're just off the boat, they're out to have a good time, they look really happy. And the perspective of this, I'm actually low down, I'm kind of kneeling when I take this picture, so I'm kind of looking up at them. It gives a slightly kind of a hero look to them. Okay, flick to the basketball one, because I really like that one.
Yep.
Yeah. So this is actually, it's very hard to photograph people in motion. And I don't know if you guys have ever tried to photograph skateboarding or somebody playing soccer or whatever, but I found these guys on the corner of 6th Avenue and Houston Street. And I kind of loved it because, you know, there's graffiti there. The graffiti's not there anymore, of course, but the basketball court is still there. And they were just two guys playing basketball. And I asked them if I could take some pictures. I came back the next day, actually, with my big camera, my Hasselblad, which is hard to photograph with. And I took a bunch of pictures of them. And I really wanted to get the idea of the energy that it takes to play basketball. Like this picture, they're both in the air. and you can see the guy on the left is like aiming at the net. And I think it just has a lot of energy, and obviously he's being blocked by his friend, and it's like a collision. And it's just, to me, this is like a super exciting picture. And it got used on the back of a book that you guys actually had something to do with, I think, for the basketball. Is that exhibit still up?
Yes, and the museum will be reopening on, I believe, August 27th, but people should check the website for that. But yes, City Game is still an exhibit that is on view at the museum.
I highly recommend, if anybody has any interest in basketball, to go see that show. It's an amazing show. I think this picture is actually in it too. So on a wall somewhere. And it just has, it has photography, it has bleachers, it has like uniforms. It's an amazing show. So if you can come to the museum, I recommend that highly. But yeah, I love this. So these are just two friends, Julian and Damien. This is actually my friend Kathy, who I was working with, and she is actually now doing construction, but we wanted to get a picture of her posing where it looked like she was up in the sky in New York. And there's a very famous picture by a photographer, Lewis Hines. And when was that picture taken, Joanna? Maybe?
I believe 1930s.
Right.
As the Empire State Building was being built.
Yeah, you guys have probably seen it. These guys are actually sitting on a beam and they look like they're suspended in the air having lunch or something. So that picture was in the back of my head when I decided to pose Kathy. She's actually standing on the bottom of one of those water towers that you see on the top of buildings in New York City. And she looks really tough. She's carrying that, I don't know what that thing is. It's like, I don't know what you call that, some kind of iron thing. And, you know, it's also unusual to have a woman doing construction. And she's got the hard hat on. And I don't know, it's just
like such a beautiful image, and the perspective of it is really magnificent.
Right.
And I so appreciate the representation of so many women in your work, Janette, from the mashup to this. It's just a really beautiful image. And we have a lot of questions coming from the group now about your process. Folks are asking about how you create a composition, if any of it is kind of planned in advance or if it's all happening in the moment. And also when you choose to shoot in black and white. So that's a lot of questions, but people have a real interest in kind of how you come about taking these spectacular scenes of New York.
Well, that picture of Kathy standing at the bottom of the water tower, the woman construction worker, I planned that because I wanted to find a rooftop where you could see the Empire State Building so we know it's New York. And so we found this roof and we had to get permission to go up there. But obviously, you know, it works perfectly. And I really love this picture. But then on the other hand, the next picture, which is of two brothers at the Puerto Rican Day Parade, which, yep. This picture is not planned at all. I love parades, and I like to go to the parade before it starts, just, you know, to see everybody gathering, because that's when you can actually get shots of people before they're actually marching. So I got this, I went up to these two guys and they told me they were brothers, and obviously they're proud of their Puerto Rican heritage. They've got the flags and everything. And it definitely wasn't planned. It's just a moment in time, and you see they're looking directly at me, and it's nice sometimes when your subjects look right in the camera like that. It's very strong. And, you know, the background, I couldn't have planned this. It was just, you know, it just happened. I bumped into them, I asked them, we got this shot, and it really is. And as far as black and white, I'm a huge fan of black and white photography, and probably most of my favorite photos taken by other people are done in black and white. I'm a huge fan of it. And often I shoot stuff in color digitally and turn it, because, you know, you can do that very easily if you have an iPhone, into a black and white picture. And it tends to make it look a little bit more like a piece of art, maybe.
And Janette, I know you talked to me about some ideas for how young people can get started in their work, photographing several times throughout the day. Can you speak to that a little bit more about, you know, coming up with a schedule or a rhythm for taking images?
I mean, photography is also, you know, you have to be into it and you have to want to do it and you have to be passionate about it. But I had this idea, which I think now because of, you know, COVID and the times we're living in, where a lot of people pretty much staying around their houses now, I think it would be really great if you guys could perhaps try and make a visual, take 3 photos per day for a week of what your life is like. So, you know, you can do this very easily on your iPhone or your phone, or you could, you know, if you have a camera, you can obviously use your camera, but it's pretty easy. You know, you just go in here and take the picture and that's it. You got your picture. And I think it would be cool if you, say, made a little kind of schedule for yourself, like perhaps in the morning, you do 1 in the morning when you're getting up, or you take a picture of your little brother asleep, or, you know, whatever, your mom's making breakfast, something that sort of says what your life is like in the morning. Then maybe you do 1 during the day. I don't know, if you guys like have a backyard, you could take a picture hanging out in the backyard, or, you know, playing basketball or whatever you may do if you're allowed out on the street, or walking the dog, you know. And then 1 in the evening, maybe, you know, somebody's watching TV, maybe you live with your grandma and she's asleep, you take a picture of her while she's sleeping. And you do that every day for a week. So that would make 21 pictures. So a morning picture, an afternoon picture, and an evening picture. And that will make like a little visual diary of exactly how your week went. And I think Joanna has something to say about how we might be able to.
Right. So, you know, we hope, our greatest hope from the session is that you feel inspired to pick up your own camera and take pictures. And I will share some information at the end of the session. Should you want to share with the museum's community, you can use the hashtag MCNYKids and have a grown up within your family share it on social media, tagging the museum. So I will share that at the end, but we would love to see kind of the inspiration you're drawing from many of these photographs as you develop your own work. And other, so, yeah, so go ahead, Janette.
The other thing I have to say is don't be afraid to get close in to see people's faces, you know, or don't have too much background around there. You want to actually be close in and see people's faces, or, you know, at least full body like this kid. And I think, don't be afraid to ask. Don't be afraid. Go on to the other idea, Joanna.
For the signs?
Yeah.
Okay, let me move into that. Well, would it be okay if we show some of the video to lead in?
I would love that. Please.
Yeah, so, most recently, Janette has been photographing the recent demonstrations for Black Lives. And with the current uprisings after the killing of George Floyd, Breonna Taylor, Maude Arbery, Tony McDade, and many others who lost their lives from police and vigilante violence, especially as COVID-19 has disproportionately affected Black and Brown communities all over the city. Janette has been taking to the streets, capturing the sustained movement of protest happening throughout the city. And so in a moment, we're going to watch a short excerpt. When They See Us, Jose James to Janette Beckman's photographs of the recent demonstrations for Black Lives.
When they see her standing on the edge of a knife, don't let go, stand tall. When they see us standing on the edge of the night, let them know who we are. We're walking in the shadows of yesterday's injustice, but only when it matters do they see us.
And so, Janette, if you could, you know, tell us a little bit more about these images and what you wanted to capture and document about this movement, in addition to your collaboration with Jose James.
Sure. Well, I live in downtown New York, and when the demonstrations started to happen, I mean, I'm a photographer, and I would hear people shouting the end of my block. I couldn't help myself. I ran outside with my camera. And this is actually on Broadway, like two blocks away from my house. I just thought it was really important to capture this moment in history. And, you know, hopefully it will inspire everybody to go out and register to vote and vote this year. I have been documenting the demonstrations ever since they started, and I've been on bike demonstrations. I've been, you know, I've marched with all sorts of different types of demonstrators. And to me, it's just amazing to see, you know, younger people actually coming out and saying what they think about what's been going on and the injustices that have been happening to Black and Brown people for hundreds of years in this country. And I'm very excited that it seems to be producing some change finally. And, you know, people are still out there protesting. I'm still out there photographing. And as far as Jose James, he's an artist that I've been working with, I think, for about 8 years. And this is like the first album cover I did for him when he just got signed to Blue Note. And we're still working together. He started a collective called Rainbow Blonde. He left Blue Note, which is a huge jazz label, and started a collective called Rainbow Blonde with his wife, Talia, who's also a musician and songwriter. And I'm part of the collective. I actually photograph all their musicians for them, which is great. And this is the latest album cover. As you can see, Jose now has a lot more hair. But he was putting out this song, and it's so important. It's about being Black in America, basically. And it's a really powerful song. And we were talking about it. He was going to put it out the very next day. We were talking about it one evening around 6 o'clock at night on the phone. And put a demonstration picture up on my Instagram. And then we came up with the idea of why not make a video of my demonstration pictures. And we just, together, the three of us put this collection together, and the song came out the next day, and it was on Spotify and YouTube. And, you know, I highly recommend you listening to this, because it's a very powerful, very pertinent song right now. And it's actually great to be part of a collective where you can just come up with an idea and next minute it's happening.
And I know he posted a Toni Morrison quote about the importance of having artists, you know, do work now and speaking out about injustice. And I know you wanted me to show participants these images and the I am signs as another entry point for doing photos.
Yeah, this is part of a project I actually did for another Rainbow Blonde guy, Ben Williams. Whoops, sorry about the reflection. He has, this album came out this year. He has a lot of songs about Emmett Till and We Shall Overcome. So this is actually it's almost like a mashup in a way. It's a riff on a photograph taken by an African-American photographer called Ernest Withers, who took a photo in 1968 in Memphis, Tennessee during the sanitation workers' strike. And at the time there was a lot of inequality in pay and opportunities for advancement due to racial discrimination. So they had made these signs, the garbage workers, saying, "I am a man." So it was the letters, "I am a man." So we decided, there's Ben right in the middle there where he says, "I am an artist." We decided to do this in DC, and he got together a bunch of his friends and we took this picture actually on a really rainy day, believe it or not. But everybody, I thought it might be really good for you guys as another project to make, just get a piece of paper just like this and write "I am" on it and then give it to somebody, yeah, in your house that maybe could be a teacher. I did this one, "I am a photographer." And they can just hold it up by their face and you can take a picture, close up picture of them. Just be a good way for people to pose, or they could hold it like this, a little further away. And, you know, don't be afraid to make a little art here. If you want to do a decorative "I am," just draw on that. But I feel like it might be a good way to take a portrait and ask someone to do a portrait, because everybody might just be somebody saying, "I am 7 years old," or it might be somebody saying, "I am a grandmother," or, you know, "I am a teacher," whatever it is. You know, maybe it's your dad who's a postal worker. Just, you know, to express who they are and give some kind of feeling and a document of the time. It's just another idea to keep you moving and taking pictures.
I love the concept because it's definitely a way to express something about someone that you might never know just by looking at the image alone. And right. We're getting some really wonderful questions here, Janette. Someone has asked, has the pandemic impacted how you photograph people? And how has photography informed your experience of this pandemic?
That's an excellent question. I mean, obviously, for me, I'm a portrait photographer, and a lot of, you know, what I've been doing over the years has been about people's faces. So it's challenging now because, you know, for instance, everybody on the demonstrations are wearing masks, so you can't actually see people's faces. But it's a challenge to express the power that they're still feeling, and, you know, the sentiment that maybe is just in their eyes. You're just seeing that little part of somebody. So that has been challenging, but I've really, you know, been out there to obviously social distancing and wearing a mask myself, which is very important, guys. And, you know, I highly recommend it. But, you know, you can zoom in on someone's face and just see what they're feeling, even if they're hidden behind a mask. But, you know, obviously the pandemic, there are no more photo shoots going on, you know, no musicians are asking me to do photo shoots or flying me to LA or anything like that. So things have sort of, as far as my own practice, I've been looking at a lot of the past photos that I've taken over the years. We call it archiving. So, you know, some images that I didn't remember I'd taken. And I'm working on a book now, which will be hopefully coming out, I guess, 2021, you know, about all the photos that I've taken all through the years of, you know, rebels, people who have been expressing, you know, their own art, a lot of artists, musicians, poets, and just regular people on the street.
Mm-hmm. Well, Janette, I want to thank you for your generosity today and sharing all of these wonderful insights with everyone. The questions were magnificent. So thank you for everyone who joined us today as well. we encourage you to take photos. You know, there's a variety of ways Janette talked about doing this. If you're taking portraits, you mentioned the idea of just kind of being fearless and making the subject comfortable, having a conversation. You don't have to worry about planning and posing. Janette, you also talked about creating a photographic diary, photographing at several points throughout the day to create a body of work that you can look over a series of images that you took. And also the holding up the I am sign is a wonderful way to express something that's personal to you or important. Janette's holding one up now. So we would love to see these photos. If you'd like to share them, you can use the museum's hashtag MCNYKids. Just have a grown up within your family post it if that's something you'd like to do. Janette also mentioned her wonderful archive. I spent hours looking at them, and you can do that by going to her website at JeanetteBeckman.com. You can also go to the museum's collection page and type her name into the search. Look at all those wonderful street photography images, but also of hip hop legends in the early phases of their career. If you'd like to print them out and create a mashup, you're welcome to do that as well. And we hope everyone will join us at the next MCNY Kids Create session. We have a wonderful one coming up on Tuesday, September 1st at 11 with the artist and graffiti writer Days. If you come to this session, you'll hear about his time growing up in New York as a young artist and participate in an interactive drawing activity where you'll learn how to create your own pieces. So thank you so much, Janette, for your wonderful advice and guidance and taking us through these amazing behind the scenes stories today.
Thank you everybody for joining. It's really cool, and I hope you take some great pictures. And you know, have fun doing it. Don't worry about perfection, just have fun. And you know, hopefully you'll capture some good images, and I'll be following and looking for those hashtags. Maybe I can make little comments, you know, if you do hashtag them and post them on social media. And you can follow me on Instagram, which is Janette Photo, if you want to see what I'm up to during COVID.
Amazing. And anyone who's based in Brooklyn, your images of the recent demonstrations will be projected outside of St. Anne's Warehouse. Is that correct, in Dumbo?
Yes. For the next 3 days from 8. So yeah, they're going to project them on this huge giant wall on Water Street. So that's really, really exciting.
And you said the next 3 days in the evening?
Yeah, I think it's 18, 19, 20, and then I think another 3 days, but I'll post that on my Instagram. I can't remember what the other 3 days are. I think maybe next week. So yeah.
Wonderful. Well, thank you for your wonderful questions today. We hope to see you on Tuesday, September 1st at 11 a.m. For our session with Days. Thank you, everyone.
Bye. Thanks so much.